Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Richard Wood with Z News.
Welcome back, my friends. Welcome. We will be live here with you for at least the next 30 minutes. If you're hearing this transmission, you are the resistance. Thank you for joining us for this, the 138th podcast edition of Zed News, which is a compendium of information on business, finance, economics and social and political issues worldwide, reaching over 10,000 subscribers every Wednesday and Saturday. Parts of this publication are picked up by 60 different websites weekly, exposing our ideas to over 10 million investors a week. This show is devoted to serving the needs of those of you who get it and want to get through it. And if you're wondering if this is your cup of tea, thanks for stopping by, and may your continued surfing be safe and satisfying. But for those that are looking for information, you are in good company. And I know you are in one of two places. You are well along in awareness and in the middle of preparation and planning, or you are on your way to getting there. It is Saturday, the 11th day of June 2011. Coming up on the show today, Brazilian companies are selling the most overseas bonds in 4 months. Brazil's industrial production fell in April by the most since 2008. And China's regulators plan to shift 2 to 3 trillion yuan of debt off local governments. Firstly, in European news, the failure by European regulators to make banks raise enough capital to withstand a sovereign default is complicating efforts to resolve Greece's debt crisis. The fragilities, quote unquote, of Europe's banking industry means a Greek default isn't an option. European Union Economic and Monetary Affairs Commissioner Olli Rehn said in New York last week, by delaying a decision some investors consider inevitable, policymakers risk increasing the cost to European taxpayers and prolonging Greece's economic pain. Guy Dablonet, who helps manage about $41 billion at Jupiter Asset Management Limited in London, said, quote, European officials are trying to buy time for the troubled economies to get their house in order and the banks to be strengthened, end quote. While estimates of the capital shortfall vary, the vulnerability of European banks to a sovereign shock isn't disputed. Independent Credit View, a Swiss rating company that predicted Ireland's banks would need another bailout last year, found in a study to be published tomorrow that 33 of Europe's biggest banks would need $347 billion of additional capital by the end of 2012 to boost their tangible common equity to 10% even before any sovereign default. European banks had $188 billion at risk from the government debt of Greece, Ireland, Portugal and Spain at the end of 2010, according to a report this week from the Bank for International Settlements. European lenders held $52.3 billion in Greek sovereign debt, with German banks owning the biggest share, the BIS data showed. European Central Bank President Jean-Claude Trichet signalled for the first time he may support encouraging investors to buy new Greek bonds to replace maturing securities as officials seek to stem the nation's debt crisis. While Trichet said he's against imposing losses on creditors, he indicated he'd approve of financial institutions maintaining their level of outstanding credit. He said at an event in Montreal late yesterday, quote, "That is not a default. That is something the ECB would consider appropriate," end quote. ECB policymakers have opposed any measure that could be classed as a default to avoid what European Union Economic and Monetary Affairs Commissioner Olli Rehn described yesterday as a Lehman Brothers collapse. The ECB is considering a rollover of bonds as an alternative means of easing Greece's funding squeeze to officials familiar with the matter said last week on condition of anonymity. Any private sector debt rollover as part of an agreement to provide financing to Greece would likely be considered a default by Moody's Investor Service, a senior executive said Tuesday, arguing it was hard to say how a rollover could be deemed voluntary. Bart Oosterveld, head of Sovereign Risk Group at Moody's, said, quote, "If it's voluntary, then it falls outside the default definition. It's hard to imagine in the current circumstances how it could be voluntary," end quote. Speaking to reporters in Paris, Mr. Oosterveld said a rollover, quote, "would likely constitute a credit event," end quote. His comments come as policymakers seek to come up with a plan to ease Greece's crash. France continuing its objection to any Greek bailout plan that is considered a default is pushing a proposal in which holders of Greek debt would roll it over into new bonds when it matures, senior French officials say. The officials argue that such a plan would be voluntary and likely not be considered a default. Critics of the plan point out that rolling over the debt effectively means holders of the bonds would get the same low interest rates on their new bonds that the original bonds paid when they were sold. Greek debt now trades at a significant discount, and the bond yields well into the double digits, making it unlikely that investors would voluntarily accept the low interest rate. Germany and other European governments favour a plan in which holders of Greek debt would effectively take losses in a debt exchange that would result in delayed repayment. Mr. Oosterveld said a debt exchange involving private sector creditors would also likely be considered a default by the ratings agency. He said, quote, It's hard to contemplate a credit event that can be contained by regulators and meaningful for the debt trajectory of the country. An orderly default implies a small default. If you impose small losses, it won't have a meaningful impact on the debt trajectory, end quote. Fitch Ratings also said Monday that if bondholders were asked to swap existing Greek debt for new debt with, quote, materially less advantageous terms, end quote, it could constitute a default even if bondholder participation was deemed to be voluntary. Standard & Poor's says its view on any such rollover agreement would come down to whether it was truly voluntary. But it also says any move to get most bondholders to roll over their exposure to Greece at below market rates would be considered a default. Mr. Oosterveld said efforts to secure fresh financing for Greece in whatever form are taking place against a backdrop of pressing financing needs. He said, quote, the thing about Greece is it's so late in the game. These maturities are looming, end quote. Policymakers have concluded Greece propped up last year with a 110 billion euro loan package will need more cash as soon as next spring. Mr. Oosterveld said any move to force the private sector into participating in a debt restructuring in Greece could have broader consequences. He said, quote, if policymakers show a willingness to force this on the private sector, then default risk would rise elsewhere. I know large credit events have consequences that nobody can think of beforehand, end quote. Moody's slashed Greece's debt ratings on Friday by three more notches and signalled further downgrades could come, pointing to growing signs that any rescue of the troubled country will include some sort of debt restructuring. Mr. Oosterveld said a Greek default would have the most fallout on Greek banks, followed closely by the European Central Bank and the Cypriot banking sector. He said a 50% haircut on Greek debt would, by and large, be, quote, manageable for French and German banks, end quote. Citing the average loss to bondholders in the experience of past debt defaults. In Germany, factory orders in Germany, Europe's largest economy, rebounded in April from a slump in the previous month, led by stronger demand for investment goods. Orders adjusted for seasonal swings and inflation rose 2.8% from March, when they plunged a revised 2.7%, the economy ministry in Berlin said in a statement today. Economists had forecast a gain of 2%, according to the median of 37 estimates in a Bloomberg News survey. In the year, orders rose 10.5% when adjusted for workdays. Germany's recovery is broadening as companies boost investment and hiring to meet booming export demand from emerging Asia, even as surging energy prices are sapping household spending. And countries including Greece toughen austerity measures. While first quarter growth was probably overstated, quote unquote, the economy is in good condition, quote unquote, Bundesbank President Jens Weidmann said on May the 23rd. Spain's inflation rate held near a 2.5-year high in May. Consumer prices based on European Union calculations 3.4% from a year earlier. In Mexico. Mexico is seeking to protect its economy from a worsening of the European debt crisis by stepping up measures to help keep money in the country, said Deputy Finance Minister Gerardo Rodriguez. The nation is boosting foreign reserves, extending local debt maturities, and limiting how much money banks can lend to their parent companies abroad or at home. Rodriguez said in an interview at Bloomberg's headquarters in New York. Spain's two biggest banks, Banco Santander S.A. and Banco Bilbao Argentaria S.A. own two of Mexico's four largest financial institutions. Rodriguez, 38, said, quote, "We are a lot better prepared, especially relative to other countries, for a situation that could deteriorate externally. All this points to a broad framework of creating additional spaces for a potential adverse scenario going forward. That's what we are here for, to prepare for negative scenarios," end quote. Mexican policymakers are bracing for a potential crisis 3 years after the global financial crash sparked a 20% plunge in the peso, drained more than 15% of the nation's foreign reserves, and sank the economy into its deepest recession since 1995. The economy rebounded last year to grow 5.4%, the fastest pace in a decade, and the government predicts an expansion of 4 to 5% this year. While countries from China to Brazil raise borrowing costs to combat inflation, Mexico is the only major Latin American country that hasn't raised rates this year. Mexican annual inflation was 3.3% in mid-May, near a five-year low, or 3.04% reached in March. Rodriguez said, quote, "The context around inflation for Mexico is very, very good, from any angle you want to look at it," end quote. A rally in the Mexican peso and inflation near a five-year low, luring record amounts of foreign investment into the country's bond market. International investors bought $21 billion of Mexican debt denominated in pesos in the 6 months through March, the most since the central bank began compiling the data in the 1960s. In Latin America news, a leftist former army officer with questioned human rights credentials narrowly won Peru's presidency in a bitterly fought runoff with the daughter of Alberto Fujimori, the disgraced ex-president. Brazilian companies are selling the most overseas bonds in 4 months, taking advantage of the lowest borrowing costs since November to finance infrastructure spending. This month's offerings of $9.46 billion are the most since companies issued $10.5 billion in January, which was the highest monthly figure since Bloomberg began tracking the data in 1999. U.S. high-yield bond sales climbed to a record $44.5 billion, while offerings from Mexico were the most in 11 months. Brazil's industrial production fell in April, by the most since 2008, surprising analysts who had expected output to expand in Latin America's biggest economy. Industrial production fell 2.1% from March. Output fell 1.3% from a year ago. In Australian news, shares in Qantas have slumped to their lowest point in nearly 2 years, due to an analyst downgrade of the stock and more cost-cutting measures. Shares in the airline lost 6 cents or 2.87% on Friday to close at $2.03, their lowest closing price since the middle of July 2009. Stockbrokers said the sell-off was caused mainly by a downgrade of Qantas shares by Macquarie from outperform to neutral. The downgrade was made on concerns about the company's ability to meet its financial forecasts due to the sluggish rate of recovery in ticket yields. Australian insurer AAMI, AAMI, is closing all 24 of its branches within the next 2 months due to tight budgets and more customers doing business online. The company will continue to provide telephone and online services. The insurer says 102 staff will be affected by the decision, but it hopes to move up to half of them to call centres. AAMI, which is owned by Suncorp, which recently saw a 39% fall in first half net profit due to the natural disasters over the summer. The company has branches in Queensland, New South Wales, Victoria, Tasmania and the Northern Territory. AAMI denies the closures are a cost-cutting measure, saying they are a response to customers doing more business online. Spokesman Ruben Atchison says it is not worth keeping the branches open because such a small number of people use them. The struggling Aussie manufacturing industry has shrunk to below 50 points, indicating contraction, according to the Private Sector Performance of Services Index. New car sales have slumped for a third month in a row. 77,000 cars were sold in May. Now, that's a drop of 13% in the year to May. For the week ending June the 3rd, the Aussie share market was unable to claw back any of its losses, which saw it record the biggest drop in a year. Local investors were nervously expecting further weakness in the US economy, which is likely to put more downside pressure on Aussie stocks. The All Ordinaries fell 17 points to 4,666, while the ASX 200 also shed 17 points to 4,583. The golden egg of the local economy, the mining sector, remains under pressure due to more weak manufacturing data out of the US and China raising concerns about future demand for Australian resources. Another local economic weather cock, airline travel, was in action again this week as Tiger Airways announced it will cut back on flights from August the 1st to improve profitability and customer relations in Australia. Tiger will temporarily suspend two flights to Queensland from Victoria and New South Wales. As part of Fair Work Australia's annual wage review, workers will receive a 3.4% increase to the minimum wage. The announcement has been criticised by unions who say the rise barely keeps up with the escalating cost of living and does little to close the gap between the low-paid workers and the rest of the workforce. The wage increase of $19.40 lifts the minimum wage to $590 per week. The recently reported Bureau of Statistics national gross domestic product GDP figure of -1.2% in the March quarter was the biggest quarterly contraction since the recession of the early 1990s. The fall is larger than the 0.9% contraction at the height of the financial crisis in late 2008 and is the worst result since the March quarter of 1991 when the economy shrank 1.3%. Critics say real GDP contraction is much worse. In light of the politically polished ABS figures, with worse to come. The number of new homes approved fell in April as the amount of new loans also remained flat compared to the previous month. Bureau of Statistics figures show the total number of dwellings approved fell 1.3% in April after an 8.6% rise in March. The widely watched and more stable housing approvals figure slipped 3.3%, while the more volatile other dwellings category that covers apartments rose 6.5% in seasonally adjusted terms. The trend estimate, which looks past month-to-month volatility, also fell 0.9% in April and has been slipping for the last 6 months. New South Wales saw the biggest slump in total dwelling approvals, which slid 12.9%, with Western Australia and Tasmania also recording steep falls. Reserve Bank figures indicate that the subdued housing and consumer sectors are likely to stay in the doldrums, with loans to private sector flat in April after rising 0.6% in March. Over the year to April, total credit rose by just 3.3%. Housing credit was up a modest 0.4% in April, but personal credit, such as credit cards and personal loans, fell 0.3%. Business credit partially reversed a strong rise in March, with a 0.6% fall in April. It is now down 1.1% over the year to April. Japan's debt rating was put on review for a downgrade by Moody's. Faltering growth prospects and, quote, a weak policy response, end quote, may hinder government efforts to cut the nation's debt burden, said Moody's, which had put Japan's AA2 rating on negative outlook in February. South Korea's inflation exceeded the central bank's target for a fifth straight month in May, adding to the case for the bank to raise interest rates. Consumer prices rose 4.1% from a year earlier, after a 4.2% gain in April. Exports advanced 23.5%, missing projections. In Chinese news, China's regulators plan to shift 2 to 3 trillion yuan off debt off local governments, sources said, reducing the risk of a wave of defaults that would threaten the stability of the world's second biggest economy. The plan is the first concrete move by the government to tackle the bad debt in local government financing vehicles. It could boost investor confidence in Chinese banks, which provided many of their loans as part of the massive economic stimulus program launched by Beijing in late 2008. That program resulted in unfettered lending to local government financing vehicles, hybrid government company bodies that governments use to get around official borrowing restrictions. Beijing has determined from a months-long investigation that local governments have borrowed around 10 trillion yuan, said one of the sources. The governments may default on around 2 trillion yuan of loans, the Chinese media have reported. China's home prices rose for the ninth straight month in May, as smaller cities withstood government efforts to curb risks of asset bubbles, according to Sufun Holdings Limited. Home prices gained 0.5% in May from April. Residential prices increased in 76 out of 100 cities tracked by Sufun, with average home values nationwide climbing to 8,819 yuan a square meter China's plan to rein in property prices with a record home building program may worsen local debt risks, even as it proves a boon to companies from domestic cement makers to Chilean copper exporters. Premier Wen Jiabao aims to build 37 million low-cost homes by 2015, an initiative that will see 2 trillion yuan added to local government borrowing by 2012, bringing it to a total 12 trillion yuan, Standard Chartered PLC estimates. The surge of loans to local authorities may spark a wave of bank bailouts that hobble economic growth. Fraser Howie, who co-wrote Red Capitalism, The Fragile Financial Foundation of China's Extraordinary Rise, and has been an investment banker in Asia for almost 2 decades, said, quote, "We're going to see more financial shenanigans. We're going to see more money pushed off balance sheets as banks seek to mask the extent of their lending to local governments," end quote. Before signing off today, we would like to thank all of our subscribers for making these broadcasts happen. None of this would have been possible without your continued valuable feedback and support. New listeners are able to follow me on Twitter at Richard J. Wood or the Z News Feed, on our Facebook fan page for the latest stories we are following, and to hear my regular radio interviews on the air or online. Also, don't forget to like and also to share these podcasts with your Twitter followers and your Facebook friends. Coming up on the program tomorrow, a special stand-alone broadcast. Who really owns the Reserve Bank of Australia? Don't miss it. Be sure to join us then. I'm Richard Wood, and this has been Z News. Because you can handle the truth.